This week's episode of So Wrong It's Right was brought to you by Foxy Bingo. Put some fox in your day with new, quick and interactive bingo experiences all at the tip of your finger. They have a huge range of free, classic and exclusive games you can play with your mates to keep the party going. Want to connect with other players? Foxy Bingo has a community chat so you can always feel part of the Foxy pack. So get your fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18 plus, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply.
How are you?
Phoenix.
Yeah. She was like,
studio.
I was like, oh, I don't know what's going on. But I'm doing it now, so I'm here.
You're here. You look amazing. The wedding, all the girls going to be there?
Well, the fucking better be. Am I allowed to swear? Well, no one knows how old Jerry is. And I promised my dad on his deathbed that I would leave the abuser. That means I've got to admit that to myself. So you end up just staying in a situation that you think is going to get better, and it doesn't get better.
Spice Girl reunion at Glastonbury.
There you go, I'm in.
Mel B, welcome to So Wrong It's Right.
Oh, thank you for having me. I have been like waiting for this day because Phoenix was really annoyed that you were not in like my PR book tour thing. I was like, oh, all right, I'll put her in. I have to put her in. So yeah, thank Phoenix. But if I hadn't have done this, I would have been in the doghouse. So I'm glad to be here.
I am internally indebted to Phoenix for this. And for those that you don't know who are listening or watching at home, I know your daughter Phoenix. We did the games, the ITV show together, which was a group of celebrities, hate calling myself that, but doing Olympic
challenges.
And you came down a couple of times.
The fact that Phoenix was actually open to doing that was, I was quite distraught because she's not a workout person. She doesn't lift weights. She doesn't run. She doesn't do anything activity-wise apart from sit on the, well, I shouldn't say that. She's very active.
But you say that, but she still did better than me. I think I came last out of all the girls and I decked it twice. And by the time I left, I had a strapped up shoulder. I had injuries for a lifetime, but your daughter, I mean, she is got that infectious energy.
It was a fun show to
we
watch
laughed every
also,
day.
Because you were all really competitive.
It was, my it got God. Like, I didn't get too invested in the competition, but by the end, I was like, these guys are losing their head over this show.
That's what Phoenix was saying.
It was got
about
like really
herself
crazy.
Too.
Yeah, she got really into it. Mel B, MBE, Sunday Times bestseller, patron of Women's Aid, mother, TV star, Spice Girl. There's so much I want to unpack, but I know I haven't got you forever. So I want to dive in straight away with the book, brutally honest. Released in 2018, now re-released with three new chapters.
Yeah, I had to update people because a lot has happened since the first release of the book.
Yes.
Yeah, a lot. So I felt compelled to update it a little bit for anyone who cares to have an update.
They all definitely the care. Yeah. You talk about, you know, obviously your struggles and that, and it's like brutally honest, the title says it on the tin.
I mean,
it's really takes you there and it paints the picture. And I think that the way you talk about domestic violence and obviously the work you do with Women's Aid is so important because I've heard you say that we are in an epidemic.
Yeah, it's getting worse, actually.
Why do you think that is?
I think because, you know, we don't feel safe with the Met Police. We don't feel safe reporting domestic violence. So it's gone into an epidemic. It was one woman a week got killed by her former partner or current partner. Now the statistics have changed again. It's now two women a week. And it predominantly does happen to women. It happens to men too.
Yeah.
But I mean, if we don't do something about it and educate ourselves, our women, our powerful, beautiful, strong women are just going to be getting killed, basically.
Yeah.
Basically, with no help or support. I mean, you've got refuges that women can go to seek like safety and shelter, but they're even getting closed down. You know, this is, I mean, thankfully we're not in such of a bad situation as America is, but still two women a week, every 30 seconds, there's a domestic call to the police. And sometimes the Met Police will show up. The police will show up. The abuser is that manipulative that the
victim ends up being arrested rather than the abuser.
Yep.
And so, you know, we know what these abusers are capable of. We already know the pattern that they do, starting off with love bombing and then the trickle, slow trickle, drip, drip, drip of making you feel unconfident and then controlling you. So if we know what they do, then we're one step ahead. We just need to act and get laws changed and educate our kids. That's why I'm so proud of Phoenix, because she goes into schools and she teaches people what a healthy relationship should look like.
I think you've hit the nail on the head there, because like you say, some of the ways abusers work is so subtle. And there was a quote in the book that actually gave me goosebumps, and I hope I don't butcher it now. As your ex-husband, he talked about, if you boil a frog slowly of warm water, they don't know they're being boiled. Yeah. And you said you had a realisation where you're like, I'm the frog.
Yeah.
And I think that's how women like yourself and so many women and men end up in these situations, because it's happening so slowly and
really
subtly.
You don't even realise it. And then before you know it, you are in a full-on physical, physical abusive, mentally abusive, financially abusive, and then you're trapped and you have no way out.
Yeah.
Because don't forget, you know, I married this person.
Yeah.
And I stayed with this person for 10 years. So I felt like I just couldn't get out. And by that point, I'd already been like sectioned off or isolated from my friends and from my family. So even if I did think, right, I'm definitely going to leave him, where would I go? I haven't spoken to my friends in what seemed like a few days, but then it was a few weeks and then it was a few months. You know, I'd book a luncheon with one of my girlfriends and then my ex would surprise me with a lovely dinner.
Because he wanted to make sure you wouldn't attend the lunch to connect with your friends.
And then I didn't know that that phone call was made to them saying she doesn't want to see you anymore, or to my mum or to my sister. And so it's not just you that ends up being abused. It's your friends, your family. And then it took me 10 years to get out after I tried to leave at least 6 or 7 times.
You, in the book at the back, it's great. There's a checklist where you can basically look for signs of abuse. And you speak about the fact that at one point, every single one you could
tick. Yeah, well, the thing is, Louise, who wrote the book with me, Louise Gannon, my dear friend and fantastic writer, she put these 15 signs of abuse in front of me. And she went, what do you think of that? And I'm like, because I was just done talking about abuse probably that day. And I went, well, it's a timeline of my marriage. And she went, no, this is from a website from a charity called Women's Aid. Wow. And these are the 15 points that they put up on their website so you can check if you are in an abusive relationship. And I was like, wow, well, I check every single one of those.
Yeah.
And that's why I put it in the back of the book, because I don't think, you know, sometimes some people have read the book and they've said to me and themselves, I didn't realise, but I think maybe I've been in a few abusive relationships, because it can happen to anyone. Yeah. There's no size, race, colour, there's no gender sometimes. You know, abuse will happen to you if the abuser wants to abuse you.
Yeah.
So the warning signs I thought was really interesting, because maybe if I'd have seen those on the back of a toilet somewhere or had the opportunity to have access to a computer, which I didn't for 10 years, maybe that would have made me think twice and just know that I wasn't that alone. Because when I brought the book out, I thought it was going to end my career, because I thought in my own little world, I was the only one that's going through this.
But also there's this shame and there's this guilt that society puts on women. So it's like, because it's like, you know, it's icky and it's not joyful, like you say, talking about it. Are you going to be the end up being the one that people are like, oh, let's not work with her because
that's
just
what it was
talked
like.
About X and it's all a bit
that's
heavy.
What it was like. Nobody wanted to publish the book. You're talking back in 2016, 2017. Nobody wanted to publish it. Nobody wanted to book me for a TV or radio show because it was seen as a taboo topic. So I think right before it was getting published and released, I literally called Louise up and I said, I can't do it. Do not release it. And if it wasn't for Louise and Phoenix saying, you have to get this book out, think of how many other people you're helping. When I got told that enough times, I was like, well, surely I can't be the only one.
No.
And then the book flew off the shelves. They couldn't keep up with the reordering.
Which just shows how many desperate people were like, one, interested in the story, but two, were using this book to educate themselves or be like, this is me.
Yeah.
And like you say, the power of anyone talking about their experience is immeasurable. But you, as this Spice Girl, like you say, singing about girl power, telling, you know, girls, you can do what you want, stand up for yourself. And I having you here is so surreal on so many levels. But as a, you know, preteen and as a child, like, you know, one of my very early memories of feeling powerful was listening to the Spice Girls and, you know, girl power and kind of looking in the mirror and going, oh my God, girls are, we can do anything. Do you know what I mean? And then, like you say, to be that figure for so many people and then to be a victim is this insane contrast, which I think makes it even more important.
Well, I think one of the things, and I'm glad that you said that, because when you're in an abusive relationship, you are so embarrassed and so ashamed. Number one, if I say that to somebody else, what my situation is, that means I've got to admit that to myself, and I'm too riddled with shame and guilt, and I'm in the middle of this abuse, and I'm probably being blackmailed at the same time. My kids, he could take my kids off me. So you end up just staying in what you think in a situation that you think is going to get better, and it doesn't get better. I mean, luckily, I'm being patron of Women's Aid, I get to work with a lot of survivors, so we all have the same story. And this is a woman's problem. If it was a man's problem, it would have been solved, and there'd be more laws in place.
Oh my God, it happens
to predominantly, statistically, women. That's why, if I can use my platform and admit, you know, for 10 years I was girl powerless, but you wouldn't necessarily have known that when I was on the judging panel on America's Got Talent or X Factor. And I think that's really important for me also to know it wasn't my fault. The abuser hunted me down. Abusers find you. They find you when you're either at your most vulnerable or when you're either at your most successful.
Right, and because they don't stop. Attracts, whether low or high, it's an attraction.
Yeah, and especially when there's money involved, because an abuser, you know, I always describe it as that is their only job. So their job, they're going to be really good at, just like you're good at your job, I'm good at my job. I love my job. But, you know, that being abusive gives them their income, their lifestyle, their ego power, their controllingness. So they become really good and they don't stop. You know, before my ex was with me, he was already convicted of domestic violence. He's already got a criminal record. I didn't know that. And then when one of his exes said that to me, I was like, yeah, right, because by that point, he'd already told me that she's crazy.
Yeah.
Just like he was saying to me towards the end that I was crazy and everyone's going to know now. I was like, oh my God. So abusers are very good at what they do, but I think with those 15 signs at the back of the book, by educating ourselves, we can be one step ahead, because we already know that they're going to do the love bombing. We already know that they're going to marry you quick and try and force you to have a baby and isolate you from your friends and your family. And then before you know it, you feel like you truly are trapped. So we know the pattern.
Yes.
So we can break it down and stop it. And it starts from educating our kids, redoing the justice system, because if I'm in a domestic violence situation, do you think I'm really going to rely on the Met Police to save me, or the courts, the family courts to save me? No, because they're uneducated.
Yeah.
All of them.
And that's what I would say to, I'm speaking to my girls, but also to boys. This happens to everyone.
Yeah,
and that's
does.
What I would say. If you get hold of Mel's book and you look at that list, and even one of them is like, fuck, that's happening to me all
now,
the time, right now, you need to assess your situation, like, period.
Yeah, because abuse, you know, even though they cry and then you go back and they'll never do it again, whether it be physical or mental or emotional, you know, they're already on that slippery slope with you and they will drag you down, as well as, for them, lifting themselves up because they've conquered and controlled you and literally left you in pieces.
You spoke there briefly about America's Got Talent, and you were doing the talent shows, weren't you, during this marriage?
Yeah.
And you said that work was your saviour.
Yeah.
And going to work is where he couldn't get to you.
Yeah, it's my safe place, happy place.
I mean, I can't even imagine what it'd be like if you hadn't had that.
I
mean, and the fact that you, the pressure of going on to one of the biggest shows in the States on TV.
I felt so confident and comfortable and safe.
Because he wasn't there.
He wasn't allowed to be on set. He wasn't allowed to be anywhere near me. And I'm working and it's live TV. Apart from doing the auditions, which would be 10 hours a day, you know, that was my safe place. So that's one of the things that I'm introducing into a lot of big companies. I just did a panel talk with Spotify and Airbnb and Netflix. So I'm getting them to put within their HR at work. Somebody that has taken a course and can actually spot if somebody's in need of help, because I know from my own experience and speaking to survivors that work is when you feel the safest.
Yes.
It's leaving work and going home and being timed how long it takes you to leave your work to get home, and then you're back into the flight or fight mode and you are, you know, subject to abuse. And it doesn't always end well. You know, I was lucky enough to get out. Yeah. I was fortunate enough to just... Unfortunate, my father died. It gave me the courage to leave, and I promised my dad on his deathbed that I would leave the abuser. But who's to say if I wasn't in that situation, if I would still be there? For sure, I know I wouldn't be sitting here.
No. How important do you find it for women, especially, to have their own jobs and their own careers? It's something I talk about on here a lot.
I think it's so important.
You probably wouldn't have seen it, but there's this TikTok trend at the moment. It's like glamifying like traditional wife, like, you know, it's basically telling like these like young girls like staying at home and not, and you're he gives you an allowance. This is so glamorous and it's the dream. And I'm just thinking like you're talking about how your job saved you.
Yeah,
it scares the shit out of me because I think I don't want anyone, any young women, to think that is an attractive lifestyle.
But I think, you know, some women do enjoy
being a stay-at-home
mum or a stay-at-home partner. I think for me, especially in this generation, you know, there's nothing better than earning your own money and going to work and achieving something within your workplace. You know, when I grew up in the 70s, my mum's white from Leeds, my dad's black from the Caribbean, West Indies, Nevis. And my mum and dad almost had role reversal because my dad would do all the cooking. My dad would do all the food shopping, which, you know, was quite embarrassing when I started my period. And I've got my sister who's 5 years younger than me going, Melanie's put something in the trolley. I want the same. Look what she's done, Dad. And I'm like, don't look at the pads. Don't look at the lalettes or the tampons. And my dad's like, it's fine, Danielle. But I want that. Yeah, that was kind of embarrassing. But growing up, I did have a role reversal. And I also grew up in a household where I was, you know, mixed. I had white culture and black culture.
Yes.
And I think it's important to talk to your kids. I think it's important to educate them. I didn't get the education from my mum and dad about speaking up or about being vocal, but I came out like that, so they had no choice. Yeah.
Hey guys, it's Liv. Welcome to What the Foxy Moments, sponsored by Foxy Bingo. I'm hoping I can give you some advice, so let's get stuck in. Dear Liv, one of my friends admitted to taking their nail clippings, fingers and toes and keeping them to use as makeshift toothpicks at a later date. They also said they love chewing on them. They were really annoyed at me when my reaction was to be totally grossed out to the point where she kept talking about it. I was close to retching. Am I in the wrong for the way I reacted? Much love, Harriet. Oh my God, what the actual hell? Harriet, you're living with a psychopath. Like genuinely, call the police. They should be arrested with no parole. That is disgusting. You're not overreacting. I can't even, I have no words. Animal. Dear Liv, I dated this boy when I was in high school. We were both each other's first loves, but it ended because we just couldn't keep the relationship going when we moved to separate towns for uni. 10 years on, I bumped into his younger brother, 3 years younger than me, on a night out, and we really hit it off and have been on and off again flirting in the DMs ever since. We're both hinted at maybe meeting up again without explicitly asking. I think we both know it's a bit weird, but are waiting for the other one to take the leap. Am I wrong to date him? Maisie. I'm going to go out on a limb here and say, I don't actually hate it. Like, it's not ideal. It's a little bit weird. I do like the younger man myself, so the 3 years thing wouldn't bother me at all. I don't know, how serious was it with the brother? Like, would you be thinking of the brother in certain situations or, like, comparing? I don't know, there's a lot of potential for ick there. But I also just do think, like, YOLO. Like, you could just try it out. It depends. You don't want him to fall out with his brother, but I'm trying to see. You were broken up 10 years, a decade. I feel like it's fine, Maisie. I feel like, do you or do him? That was this week's What the Foxy Moments. I will see you next time.
Hey
even though you were obviously this boss bitch, career woman, this situation financially drained you.
Oh, yeah, and completely.
You've been speaking about the fact that people would find it so hard to actually fathom that you were a whole Real Spice Girl, you'd been recently on tour, and then you're back living with your mum.
Yeah.
In, you know, the rural area. How was that for you?
It was very humbling. I mean, I left America in, well, when my dad died, 2016, 17, and I couldn't buy a place because my money had been taken and put there and here and there. And then I remembered.
Because the financial control in terms of abuse is such a big thing that I think not many people know about.
No, because an abuser, you know, you are their income. You are their lifestyle. They don't work.
No.
Their job is to be a really good abuser, right in plain sight, right in front of you. And you think, how did I even get here? And then I remembered, you know, I'd be working or filming, doing whatever show in Australia or in America, and he'd be like, right, I've got my monthly accountancy meeting. And it'd be, you know, he'd say things like, you've been working all day, I'll go and do the accountancy meeting.
Oh.
And so early on you think, God, that's really nice, thoughtful. And he's cooked me dinner too, oh, that's really nice. When little do you know, at the time, is stashing away your money and all that kind of stuff. So when I left, and I left with a bang because my dad had just died, I found myself on tour doing Wembley Stadium in 2019. And then I'm, you know, living with my mum in a small bungalow with my three kids going, how did I get here? My mum thinks, well, surely you have something.
Yeah.
I'm like, no, I don't. And not only have I gone through a divorce, I've come out of the abuse, I'm now having to live with the fact that I've put myself and my kids through that. And now I have to make amends with my mother, who I haven't seen or spoken to really for 8 years. My dad's passed. I have to make amends with my sister, my whole entire family, because my mum's one of seven.
So, as is mine, actually.
Unbeknownst to me, they were being abused too. Well, Melanie doesn't want to talk to you. I didn't know those conversations went on, but that explains why.
So they all had umbrage with you, but you didn't know what the problem was.
Didn't know anything. So it's like going in there and kind of regurgitating and hoping and praying that they understand, but how is my mum to understand? Because I didn't even understand.
Yeah.
And only writing this book, because it's down on paper, do I know that, because I think of it, that did all happen to me and I have to speak out about it. Because if it's happening to me, it happens to anyone and everyone.
Yeah.
I think that's what people don't understand, but I do think now, because it is such a conversation, you know, you've got shows like Dirty John, you've got Happy Valley, you've got documentaries about coercive control.
Us,
so
way,
now it's more of a conversation.
Yes.
Whereas when I brought that book out, it was like, oh God, I'm not talking about that dark, icky, horrible
subject.
Yeah,
well, like you say, you went against the grain to do something that, like you say, you almost fucking didn't do it because you were like,
I thought
people
it was
going to
end my career.
Yeah.
I honestly thought it would. And if anything, it's almost enhanced my career, because Spice Girls don't have an MBE, but I have an MBE for my work. It's so weird. And even when I was there, and William was like, so where are the others? I'm like, it's just
not
me.
Not here, babe. I'm the only one getting MBE.
I'm like, it's just me and my mum. And I could see he was looking around going, well, where's the black?
Like, was he hoping for a reunion?
No, it was thinking, well, where's my black mother? I'm like, no, that's my mum's white with blonde hair and blue eyes right behind me. She's all nervous like that. But then I had to explain it to him and he was like, oh, yeah, for all your stuff that you're doing with Women's Aid and creating awareness, as he's pinning this thing on my chest and I'm looking down, realising Victoria's designed my dress with a big slit, so it's just tits. But, yeah, that was a real, like, moment for me, because I feel like I know, as Spice Girls, we worked our ass off and we loved spreading the word of girl power and, you know, invigorating and supporting women. And now I'm there at Buckingham Palace getting something, an award, a medal for talking about something that is seen as dark and dirty.
Yeah.
But we all know about it.
Imagine
we just
you
need
could
to
have
talk
known
about
that
it.
The night before the book when you mean, who would have believed that?
I did say it to Louise and she just scoffed at me. I said, you know, I see myself in the Houses of Parliament changing laws, and Louise is like, well, let's just get the book out first, yeah? Yeah? And then after the book is when Women's Aid read it and they said they've never read such a true account of abuse.
We'd like to have her as patron.
And I was like, oh, what does that mean, patron? What does it mean?
Because even that's a big word.
Like... yeah, I had to Google that one along with MBE.
One of the things I loved reading about is your recovery journey, because you said that you didn't love talking therapy.
No, it was like reliving it for me.
And people don't know this. It sounds off the wall, but I'm really invested in stuff like this. I think of myself as like a little bit of a part-time biohacker. But trauma causes damage to the physical 100% brain. 100%.
And your body.
And your body. If you scan the brain of someone that's been, you know, abused,
you can
physically
the trauma.
See it. Yeah. And you've done work, haven't you, to actually try and correct that.
Yeah,
because which is so interesting.
Well, at the end of the day, you can't undo what you've been through. No. And trauma, you know, people say, well, I'm fine now.
Yes.
You know, I'm not traumatized. Trauma will be with you for the rest of your life. So it's how loud you let that trauma voice take over your day or not. Like, I remember in the very beginning, if a door would slam, I would go like that, because that would remind me of some form of abuse.
Because you're on high alert, you're on like fight or flight the whole
time.
So
everything will come back. And that's why I'm really proud of our country that we have no statute of limitations. Mm-hmm. So if I want to report a domestic abuse incident, I have as long as I want, or as long as I can build up the strength. There's no set like limit on when I can report that crime. Whereas if I live in America, I have 3 years to report it since the day it happened. And then that's it.
Okay.
So here we're doing one thing right.
Yeah.
But you know, when it comes to trauma, I tried talking therapy, but it's like, I mean, any kind of rape victim will tell you, when you have to kind of talk about it, it's like you're reliving it. And then you remember a bit more about that. And it's just sends you into a dark spiral. And then PTSD can come back again in effect. So I tried alternative therapy, I like to call it.
Which I love. I'm obsessed.
Yeah. And I did one which sounds really barbaric, transcranial neurostimulation therapy. So basically, you know, you have your front lobes here, you put on a cap and everybody's brain sits a little bit differently, or your front lobes can sit a little bit differently, but it's all basically in the same region. So I had a thing, as I describe it in my book, where it gets to a point where trauma is sat at, which is quite emotional. So it was literally like a bang, like a hammer.
Sounds you like felt
like
it.
Like five, it was like 15 slow ones on that, and then it'd be 30. So you feel like, well, basically you're being hit in the head.
But
and you
the,
do that for 6 weeks.
Wave.
It's like the electric, it's like waking up that part, but in a non-traumatizing way. Even though, I mean, I sent Louise the video, she was like, oh my God, what is that? I was like, it's transcranial. Da, 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 and it's meant to
Did you
help.
Do it in the UK?
No, I did it in Europe.
Yeah, I was going
to
say.
And I wanted to try it because it is so extreme.
It's
you
so,
know.
It's kind of out there, but I've read a lot
and
about it.
And it helped. But first, I didn't start off with the barbaric stuff.
No, you
first,
went eased in.
I did EMDR.
Tapping?
I did tapping also. I did EMDR with the light. So you think of the most horrific situation. I don't know, say you've been abused mainly with a knife, which was not my case. So you say knife out loud and then you say it and you watch this thing go backwards and forwards, and it just lessens the shock of that word and that feeling.
It's fascinating.
And that helped me for a little bit.
And you're a Reiki master.
Yeah.
I mean, how insane is that?
I was trying to give Phoenix some Reiki last night. She was like, Mommy, stop. I was like, I just want to get some of this stuff off you. She went, oh, just do it on my hand. I was like, no, I need your feet so I can ground you. She was like, oh.
You got such a good impression of her.
Yeah.
It's so good.
And I actually do it on my fiancé too, which, by the way, because I've got a Reiki room on the top floor of my house, which nobody's allowed in unless I invite you in.
Because the energy is...
Yeah.
Protected.
And also me and my mum, you know, we did it ourselves and got material off Amazon. So it's a very precious room. It's a DIY job.
I love it.
And so I put Rory in the Reiki room, and he just, I'll be giving him Reiki, and I got the music and an SDR playing, and he'll go, oh, great. I'm like, so what did you see? You know, what do you feel? Oh, I've just had a lovely nap.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
I'm like, what? Just had a lovely nap. You didn't feel the energy.
No.
He goes, yeah.
Did you see anything?
Yeah. It's just, I'm really relaxed.
You're like, right, you could have done that on the sofa, love, but all the best, yeah. Rory, the fiancé.
Yeah.
You knew him for years, right?
Yeah.
On and off.
Well, he was a trusted family friend, so... Fortunately for me, you know, coming out of that horrible, abusive marriage, I wasn't looking for a relationship.
No.
Fuck no.
I mean, how hard was that to let someone in?
Or go anywhere. Well, he was a trusted friend, so...
So you knew he was a good person?
Yeah, so, yeah. For example, when I came back from LA, my hair was like this short. He called it my Rod Stewart phase because it was all badly damaged and pink from a terrible hairdresser in LA. So he'd come round and give me some hair treatment. So as he was... And I never thought I'd get my natural curls back. So as he was, as he was nurturing my curls back, he was... nurturing my self-belief and self-trust and trusting him because, you know, our hair is our everything.
Yeah.
And he just got that back feeling healthy and at the same time was getting me back feeling just a bit more like myself and a bit more trusting in somebody else. But, I mean, still back in the day, a few years ago, even when he'd come and give me a hug, I'd go like that sometimes or I'd wake up in a massive, like, panic or be dripping in sweat with a real dream, reliving some of the abuse. And he was just, you know, kind and gentle and honest and from Leeds. And I hadn't seen that. I didn't know what that felt like.
That's amazing. That's like giving me like all like gooey inside.
Yeah.
You're engaged to be married.
Yes.
And are you going to do it at St. Is it St. Paul's Cathedral?
Yeah, it is.
So
yeah.
As an MBE, you have the option to get married.
Went there. I've just got to do a final bit of documentation because I have been married twice before, so you've got to pull all your divorce papers. We've already had, like, the sit-down interview, which I quite liked because, you know, the chaplain's asking me, why do you want to be married again? And why before God? Why in a church? And it really makes you... think about it. Well, why do I? And I always said to Rory, I'm never going to get married. I'm never having kids. This is when we were not dating, but kind of were like cuddly.
Yeah.
Because it took me a long time to do anything else, basically. And I was like, this guy is a really good guy. Mm. You know, when you just, it's a good egg. A good guy and adores me and I adore him. And we have the same, like, lingo because we're both from Leeds and
same banter same
yeah but I know I wasn't looking for anything and I honestly thought if I've been through that how can I even begin to trust anybody because I was in love with that monster and I stayed with him and had a baby and that is that my judgment no well that's what abusers do they love bomb you and they come in on their horse like a knight in shining armor. Roy didn't come in like a horse, like nine, like did, like a horse, like shining armor.
I'm upset.
But he was, you know, just something that I didn't think was on the card to me. And I didn't necessarily even knew that really existed.
But like you said.
And I was like, well, you're going to get the ring wrong anyway, even if you do get engaged.
I said that to
pulled
my husband.
That off and I was like, what?
That's perfect. Unreal. Like you say, just because an abuser managed to trick you before, and I'm speaking now to everyone listening, it doesn't mean that you're going to pick someone wrong again. It just means that person was so good at manipulating you.
Oh, yeah. Well, like I said, that's their job. Yeah. So they have to be good at their job.
Yeah.
And I think anybody that's come out of that and survived that kind of relationship, trust me, you are too terrified to even give your heart to somebody. It takes a special kind of person to be able to ignite that in you again.
Yes. The wedding, all the girls going to be there?
Well, the fucking better be. Am I allowed to swear? You can beat me out. The better be.
And by the girls, I obviously mean the Spice Girls.
But I haven't got a date yet. Okay, so once I get a date...
It's not booked, but it will
no,
be.
No, but I've got to do the
happening.
Final bit of paperwork. And I'm glad it's a process that you have to go through rather than just, you know... getting hitched all of a sudden, as they say.
I am, I'd say I'm on the way to retirement party girl, but I am still a party girl. So when I read about your nickname, the Ox, it did make me think a little bit of myself. Because I'm getting worse now, but I did used to be the girl that could drink 5 bottles of wine and the next day I'd be like...
thing, though.
But you know I'm not northern.
I know, but this
I live in Manchester. I'm like, I'm
oh,
I'm
well, you
half.
Are then, because that's 45 minutes away from me.
Yeah,
so
I'm very... Could I come to the Reiki room? Yeah. Or is it too soon to ask that question?
Yeah, but I'm moving house, so okay. I haven't got my Reiki room sorted in the new house, but I'm leaving... I go to New York on Sunday, so I'm leaving all the packing of the house to do with Rory. So when I get back from New York in a couple of weeks, okay. I'll be in my new house. But my Reiki room won't be sorted then.
Right.
Because I'm going to do it proper this time. I'm not going to do it off Amazon with my mum.
You're going to do it for
I'm going to do it
the
proper.
Real thing.
Yeah.
But the Ox.
Yeah.
Are you still the Ox? Can you still throw it down?
I think so. Yeah. I mean, I think it's just built in me.
I want to play this really quick game with you.
Yes,
before
yes,
you
yes
go.
I like games.
This is called My Box of Wrong.
Right. Right.
So in honour of the name of the show, So Wrong It's Right, I'm going to read things to you. You're going to tell me if you think it's right, wrong, or so wrong it's right.
Right.
Let me go thing. Face tune on photos.
I think it's wrong.
Do
because
you?
You know why? So you see them on Instagram and then you see them in person, you go, oh.
Yeah,
I'd rather look like shit on Instagram than somebody look at me and go, oh, you look nice.
I'll take that. Wrong. Like it. Lying about your age.
Oh no, that's wrong.
Yeah. I feel like we should stop doing
Embrace your age.
My mum was here the other day and she said, oh, no, it's right. Because I don't even know how old she is.
No.
She's
well,
like,
no one knows
anyone.
How old Jerry is.
No, but that's
no
true.
One's seen a passport. I mean, I know we've travelled the world, but I still don't know how old she is.
Well, no one could get their eyes on it.
Well, she claims she just had her 50th birthday, but I don't believe her.
Obsessed.
I'm 48. Am I 48 or am I 49? I'm 48. See, I always add on a year just for shits and giggles.
Exaggerating a story for the drama.
Yes.
Yeah. No one likes a boring story. Like, come on.
Yeah.
I call it a little bit of sprinkle, a little bit of something.
Yeah, because
something.
Then it's a proper story.
Outfit repeating.
All the time. Mm. These are 25 years old.
Obsessed. Googling yourself.
Oh, I did have to do that not so long ago to find out when I actually did get divorced. So I could know what lawyer to contact to get my divorce papers.
So useful tool for you.
I think it's useful if you forget stuff or you forget how many kids you've got.
If you're world famous, you can look up. They're like, yeah, where's my birth certificate online?
No, so what happened the other day, I think I'd just come back from one of my, you know, I call them brain breaks, one of my brain breaks in Thailand.
Love that.
And so I'd got a massive all over tan. So I went to go, you know, show my passport and the guy was like, no, I was like, that's a bit racist. I've just got a tan. So I said, I'll Google myself. It is me, look.
And that did it?
Yeah, he let me through.
That's brilliant. So I didn't write this, but I'm going to just read it anyway. Wearing the same knickers 2 days in a row.
No, I don't really wear underwear that much. If I'm wearing a short skirt, I wear underwear, but I prefer not to because I feel like I'm trapped.
Reprimanding your kids for something you would definitely do.
You see, I can't do that too much.
Because they know?
Yeah, I said, do as I say, not as I do. But then, you know, you've got Phoenix with the blabbermouth and Angel blabbermouth and Madison. So I'm just like, well, just if it feels morally wrong, just don't do it.
That's a good way to do it. Which of the kids is most like you? Phoenix?
I think they've all got a little bit of me.
Mm.
Phoenix has definitely got, she's got a rage in her, which is very scary and very fiery. And we've been in a few hustles together. Damn, she's scary.
She's scary Spice. Yeah.
And so is Angel. Angel's very, you know, lawful and opinionated.
They're all
headstrong. So much so. I was in Thailand another time with Angel, and I pretended that I didn't have my money on me, even though I'd already paid the bill. So I said to Angel, we're going to have to do a runner. I said, I haven't got a wallet. Let's just run. Angel went and told the guy, we haven't got any money. This is where we're staying. And off he walked back to the hotel. I was like thrown under the bus. That's morally incorrect. If we've eaten at a restaurant, you have to pay for it.
Oh, my God, I'm obsessed.
And Madison's very much like, because she's quite, well, all my kids are very American. You met Phoenix.
She's very LA Phoenix, isn't she? And she's in her vibe.
But
and
Madison's very like, get ready with me. I'm like, what's that?
I was going to ask you to do that with me.
I need
this.
To do my elephant, drunken elephant. What is that name? It's product, mommy. And you just put a little bit of serum here. And I'm like, just wash your face.
Right, one last one. Spice Girl reunion at Glastonbury.
I don't think it's going to be at Glastonbury, but it's definitely going to happen. There you go, I'm in.
This week's episode of So Wrong It's Right was brought to you by Foxy Bingo. Put some Fox in your day with new, quick and interactive bingo experiences all at the tip of your finger. They have a huge range of free, classic and exclusive games you can play with your mates to keep the party going. Want to connect with other players? Foxy Bingo has a community chat so you can always feel part of the Foxy pack. So get your Fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18+, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply.